Good evening. I'm Tina Frank, Director of Grant Operations for the Corrette Foundation, and I'm here on behalf of Tad Toby, President of the Corrette Foundation and a member of the Commonwealth Club's Board of Governors. Tonight's program is part of the Commonwealth Club's American Values Series, underwritten by the Tad Toby Family Foundation. And now it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's distinguished speaker, American political and cultural commentator David Brooks. Mr. Brooks became an op-ed columnist for the New York Times in September 2003. He has been a senior editor at the Weekly Standard, a contributing editor at Newsweek and the Atlantic Monthly, and is currently a commentator on the PBS NewsHour with Jim Lehrer, one of my favorite programs. Mr. Brooks has written a new book, The Social Animal, The Hidden Sources of Love, Character, and Achievement, which will be released in March, and he will be speaking at the Commonwealth Club in the Silicon Valley on March 22nd. Mr. Brooks has a distinguished history of being a contributor to publications including The New Yorker, The Washington Post, Forbes, The New Republic, and Commentary. He is also a frequent commentator on National Public Radio, CNN's Late Edition, and The Diane Rehm Show. One last little-known fact about our speaker this evening is that he was born in Toronto, Canada. It is with great pleasure that I welcome David Brooks.
Thank you. Another illegal immigrant. It's somewhat of a thrill to precede Bruce Bochy to this podium. A little disturbing because I was going to talk about the future of the San Francisco Giants. And as a New York Mets fan, I say that with some bitterness. It's also, of course, a pleasure to be in the city of Nancy Pelosi, my ideological base. It's exactly the reaction I got in Casper, Wyoming. I did start out as somewhat of a lefty. You should know my parents, I grew up in Greenwich Village in New York or near there, and my parents were professors in the 60s, and when I was 5 years old, they took me to a bee-in where hippies would go just to be. And it was in Central Park in New York City, and part of the being was throwing, they set a garbage can on fire, and they threw their wallets into it to demonstrate their liberation from money and material things. And I was 5 years old, and I saw a $5 bill on fire in the garbage can, and I ran up to the fire, reached into it, and grabbed the money and ran away. That was sort of my first step over to the right. You actually never know where life will take you. I was a Jewish kid, but I was part of the, I went to Grace Church School. I was part of the all-Jewish boys davening choir at Grace Church. And I thought I was going to live a nice assimilated life until I married a woman who was a Protestant, who then converted to Judaism about 3 years after we were married. And now we keep a kosher home. Our kids go to Jewish day school. She announced she wanted to become a rabbi. My line is, this is how we know God exists, because only he would go so far out of his way to screw me this badly. So life has its surprises, but we're still happily married, and we were out here last week. I come out here quite a lot on business, but we were out last week, and for the first time, two of my three kids had never been to San Francisco, so we walked around, and I just showed them the city. And it was a wonderful trip. And actually, just before this event, I had a chance to walk around the city for an hour or two. And it was funny, when I walked past a block that I had walked with my kids, even though I'd been on that block many times before, when you've been someplace with your kids, it has an extra emotional oomph to go back to it and see it and remember the time you were there with your kids. Stendhal had this concept of crystallization, that when you're with something that emotionally affects you, that it crystallizes it, it creates a glimmer and a glow around everything that you touch with that person. And so I had sort of a weird walk today, seeing the things I'd seen with my kids just last week. And I start on that psychological theme because I'm going to try not to talk too long. I've been with San Francisco audiences before, and I know you didn't come here to hear me speak. You came here to hear yourself speak. But but I am going to talk about psychology, oddly enough, and political events, but through a psychological lens. And I'm going to do it in sort of three different sections, but all of which going back to this concept of psychology. And I felt I should start, I felt I really had no choice but to start with the events in Tucson of the last week. And one of the things when I started my career as a police reporter in Chicago covering crimes, and the thing you learn in the institution of journalism practiced correctly is always that seeing is more important than thinking. Then the most important thing is to look at the evidence first. And so there's been a lot of punditry and commentary around what happened in Tucson. But I think if we start with the evidence, and we start with what little we know about Jared Loughner, the kid who allegedly committed this thing, is we know that he has had, from his online writings, an obsession with mind control, and you see in the writings a struggle of a man trying to control his mind. We know he created these videos, and the last video he created was called My Final Thoughts. And if you go online and watch those videos, what you see is a man who's trying to create what he calls a currency, which is a language for controlling thoughts. And you see him sort of vaguely understanding that he's having trouble controlling his own thoughts, and then saying, making accusations about the government controlling our grammar. And they're all about the struggle to control thoughts. And then we know from testimony from his friends, first, as we've learned today, that his friends more or less cut him off for the last several months because they found his behavior too disturbing. But we know he went to this town hall with Congressman Gifford and asked her an extremely bizarre question, having to do with how can government function when words have no meaning. And out of this, he was dissatisfied with her answer. So we see all the evidence that we have in front of us suggesting that the root cause of this, or what was involved with this, is a young man possibly suffering from mental illness and possibly from schizophrenia, and not practicing politics as it's normally understood. And that's sort of where the evidence, to the extent that we have it, leads us in that direction. And yet I think so much of the commentary in the last few days has not been following that evidence, but has gone off in a different direction, talking about civil discourse in our politics. And I'm all for civil discourse, I'm all for sensible politics, but there's no evidence that was germane to this kid. And I think journalism has been guilty of a great wrong in not following the evidence over the last 4 days. And so the people who talked about civil discourse in regards to this, I think we're simply talking about a thing that was not germane to this particular tragedy. And those who accused political players of contributing without any evidence, I think, made extremely grave accusations without any sense of responsibility. Now, I'm not sure there's a larger political meaning to this horrible thing, but if there is, I think it is a function that we in the media have to pay much greater attention to psychology and psychological issues, and less to politics. Not everything is explicable by the normal political logic. But the second thing is, and I think we as a society have to pay greater attention to the treatment of the mentally ill. We have a system, and really part of the system was created here in California during the Reagan governorship and has spread outward, of giving people suffering from severe mental illnesses the choice to control their own destinies. And often that means that they end up on the streets. A large number of them end up in jails. 99% of them are not violent in any way, but 1% or so are violent. And I think we have to ask some fundamental questions. The most important question, I think, is how do we allow a kid who is widely perceived as mentally troubled to get access to guns? This And the second is, how do we think about involuntary commitments and involuntary treatment? Have we erred too much on the side of giving those people individual choice, and do we need to shift more to protect community safety? I think we probably do, not that I'm an expert. But that to me is the fundamental issue before us, and the treatment and the overt politicization of this event frankly has made me angry over the last few days, because I think it's not journalism at its best. So that's my first little psychological theme tonight, and just off the news of the day. The second is broader, and it comes back to my normal life in Washington. And that is the importance, when you look at politics, of thinking of psychology. I was given a good piece of advice by a guy named Robert Novak when I took my current job, and he said, interview 3 politicians every day, because it'll teach you to get to know them. And I spend a lot of time around politicians, and from that experience, I can tell you they're all emotional freaks of one sort or another. They have what I call logorrhea dementia, which is they talk so much they drive themselves insane. They're guaranteed to invade your personal space, so you'll get up and you'll talk to them, and they'll grab you by your lapels, they'll stroke the back of your head. I had a Republican senator who grabbed my inner thigh throughout an entire dinner and squeezed it for emphasis. And they have these intense social skills. If you want to put it that way. And if they don't have it, they work on it to make sure they get it. I recall covering Mitt Romney during the last presidential race, and he went up to, I was covering him in New Hampshire, and he was campaigning with his 5 perfect sons, Bip, Chip, Rip, Sip, Dip, and Lip. And so we go into a diner, he goes around to each table in the diner, and he introduces himself to the people at the table, and it says, what village in New Hampshire are you from? And they mention the name of a village, and he describes the home he owns in their village. And then he goes around, and he meets about 30 or 40 people, and as he's leaving the diner, he waves, and then he first names everybody he's just met. And I was like, whoa, this is a profession I will not be going into. But that is the sort of psychological skills that many of them have and the psychological complexity many of them had. And I asked a friend who's in government now, or was in government, what's the one thing you've learned being in government you didn't know before? And I asked that question to almost everybody I interview. Often the answer will be something like, actually President Bush at the end of his term told me, there's a lot of passive-aggressive behavior in government that I didn't really know, which is, he was absolutely right about that. Often people say that our military is way more sophisticated than I thought. Our intelligence is much worse than I thought. But this particular person said, you know, I used to think politics was about 75% personality and relationships. Now I realize it's 99% personality and relationships. And people, especially people in public life, are just odder than you can possibly imagine. Maybe we're all odder than we can possibly imagine. But the story I tell to illustrate that was told to me by a guy named Kraft, Bob Kraft, who owns the New England Patriots. And he was in a business delegation. He went to Russia, and he had a meeting with Putin, with his other business leaders. And Kraft's team is a great team, and they've won the Super Bowl. And he had on his finger his first Super Bowl ring. And Vladimir Putin saw this ring and said, in the middle of the meeting, and said, can I see that ring? And Kraft handed it to him, and Putin put it on his finger. And then during the meeting, Putin's gesturing with the ring on his finger. And at the end of the meeting, Kraft says, you know, Mr. President, I'd be happy to make you a copy of that ring, but that particular ring has great sentimental value to me. It's our first Super Bowl ring. And Putin pretends he doesn't hear. And he puts the ring in his pocket. And then Kraft goes back to the State Department and says, you know, I didn't want to make a big international incident, but I'd really like that ring back. I'll make him a copy. I'd be happy to. So the State Department people at the embassy send their feelers out to the Kremlin, and they come back to him the next day, and they say, you know, we think we are going to issue a press release that you've decided to donate that ring to the Russian people. And that's exactly what happened. And this has been publicly reported since, but it's a sign that our entire world is run by 4-year-olds. And so when you cover politics, you're always got to be aware of this psychology. And even among the people you admire, I'm to the right of Barack Obama, but I'm a personal great admirer of his, and for many personal traits. But one of the things that you've seen, when you put psychology at the center of you, psychology changes as context changes. There's a great concept called the fundamental attribution error, which is the mistake of attributing to a permanent character trait things which are actually the product of context. And so, for example, Obama has various traits, but they change as the context changes. So one of the traits I admire in him is a genuine niceness. Usually when I criticize a candidate or a politician or a president, the aides call me the next morning and they scream at me, David, you're a complete and total idiot. With the Obama people, they call you the next morning and they say, David, we really respect your work. We love you. You know how much we admire you. It's so sad you're a complete and total idiot. And so that niceness, I thought made you feel good. It was one of the nice things about the administration. But I would say over the last 3 months, as I've talked to people in the administration, they've begun to see a downside to that niceness. And that downside is there's no fear of the president within the government. And so I recently was talking to somebody, and he said, you know, you'd be amazed how little the sentence, the president has already decided this, matters in a meeting. So the government just wants to go off their own way. The president's made the decision, but they're going to go off on their own way anyway. And another member of the administration told me, you know, we know there's this culture of no drama, Obama, of niceness, so we know if there's a really problematic issue, we're going to try to not to bring it to the inner circle because they'll reject it, because they don't want the violence and the conflict. And so you've begun to see the administration straight up to the president begin to acknowledge that this trait, this niceness, which was so good in many circumstances, is not so good when the government is going off on its own and ignoring the president, which happens a lot. And so that's a psychological trait, and you begin to see him adjust and actually name a new chief of staff, Bill Daley, in part to take care of this problem. The second trait that he has, which has changed meaning, I think, over the last few months, is the trait of self-confidence. I'm convinced the word Obama will be the unit of measure for self-confidence in about 80 years. So we'll say, oh, he has 80 Obamas, he has 120 Obamas. People in this job have a high degree of self-confidence, but Obama is sort of off the charts. And this, I think, negatively, especially in the first couple of years, caused him to think he could just control the country. And I think it led him to misread the country. But I would say in the past 2 months especially, and as I've covered and watched him adjust to the electoral disaster he really suffered, in a very cool and calm way, he's shifted and adjusted and seen his own situation without a sense of self-pity or defensiveness, just analytic, because he knows he can change without fundamentally altering his faith in himself, which I believe is unshakable. And so that has been a good side to the self-confidence, which earlier appeared hubris, now to me it appears more as security. Now the Republicans have changed too over the last few months. Now the Republican Tea Party is something we all saw last year, and my one-line explanation of it was people who use Abby Hoffman means to achieve Norman Rockwell ends. And so there was a search for sort of an old-fashioned America, an order and a security, but using Abby Hoffman frantic gestures and sometimes overheated rhetoric to get there. And to me, that part was a real problem. But I've covered the new congressmen as they've come into Washington, and I will tell you they are, by and large, a much more impressive group than I anticipated. Most of them were successful businessmen and women. Many of them were really extremely successful legislators. Marco Rubio was Speaker of the Florida House. And out of government, they indulged in the luxury of believing what it was pleasant to believe. In government, they've had a series of meetings over the last couple of weeks where they've now had to grapple with the things actually involved in government. So, you know, out of government, they could say, we'll slash the federal budget by hundreds of billions of dollars. And now they've sat in these meetings, these orientation sessions, and they say, oh, we're going to cut the government in half. Do you want to cut defense? Nah. Do you want to cut Medicare? Nah. Social Security? Nah. Well, here's what's left. And now they grapple with that. And believe me, they still think they're going to cut. They still say, okay, we'll cut. It's going to be tougher, but we will cut. And they've grappled it like business people. And then you say, well, you know, we're in the middle of a fiscal year. The government has already signed contracts. You really can't cut in this much in the middle of a contract. And they say, okay, acknowledge that. We'll scale back a little. And so I've seen an evolution in things. I've also seen an evolution in their opinion of President Obama. Many of them came in believing that he was a socialist who wanted to make us Sweden. I think because of his gestures, and believe me, I argued this case that he was not, that he was sort of a moderate liberal pragmatist, but believe me, I made no headway with these people until I'd say in the last couple weeks, there's beginning to be a glimmer of opening. And so the psychology has shifted, I think, for the better. And so if you had asked me months ago, are we headed for gridlock? I would have said, absolutely, gridlock, nothing gonna get done, fiscal disaster. Now I'd say, there's probably a two-thirds chance that will happen. But when you see the psychology shift, you begin to think there's more possibility for compromise, for flexibility, for getting rid of, for averting some of the disasters ahead of us. And I say that because the psychology has shifted, this new optimism I'm manufacturing for myself. I say that because various things simply have to happen. We have to raise the debt limit. We have to pass a budget. Circumstance will impose certain compromise. And I say that in part because of the Simpson-Bowles Deficit Commission, which has had a big cultural effect on Washington and maybe the country. Those people, while they didn't get their thing enacted, they put everything on the table. And so when you go from congressional officer to the White House or to the Treasury Department, every single policy is now up for discussion, whether it's Social Security, taxes, defense budget, education budget, entitlement reform. It's all there, and people are talking about it in much more radical ways than before. And then finally, and this I know from conversations with the president and those around him, the president, especially in the State of the Union speech, sees a need to reframe the whole debate. We've had the big government versus small government debate, which is like trench warfare we're all used to. But there's another way to talk about it, which is not big government or small government, but the quality of government. Does government enhance social mobility and achievement, or does it not enhance social mobility and achievement? And this breaks down the frame, the traditional frame we've had. There's a tradition in this country which has been neglected over the past 30 and 40 years. We all know the conservative movement that believes in limiting government to enhance freedom. We know the liberal movement that believes in using government to enhance equality. But there's a third tradition in this country which has gone neglected, and it believes in limited but energetic government to enhance social mobility and industry. It begins with Hamilton, it goes to Lincoln, the Railroad Act, the Homestead legislation, it goes to Teddy Roosevelt, it jumps to California in the middle of the 20th century, where you had the government using government funds to create the best school system in the country, the highways, the water projects, using government to enhance growth and productivity. And when you start talking about those terms, using government to enhance capitalism and productivity, as opposed to big government versus small government, you break the intellectual logjam. When you go to the conservative Republicans or the liberal Democrats, you find them agreeing on what government needs to do to enhance productivity, things like infrastructure programs, human capital programs, energy reform. If you reframe the debate in that way, suddenly some of the old debates are there, but they can be fenced off. And I think the president knows that. I think in the State of the Union, he's going to try to do it. The other thing they're trying to do is sequencing policies correctly. So you begin with some agreement, and then you progress step by step. And so the president is greatly drawn to the idea of doing tax reform, some big tax reform first, because we agree on what needs to be done. We need to simplify the tax code and lower the rates. And then there are so many moving parts, you can actually begin to get agreement. So for all these reasons, some of the polarization, some of the gridlock, which seemed inevitable, I think now, while likely, are not inevitable. And the psychology is beginning to shift a little. And so I'm oddly hopeful about Washington the way I wasn't months ago. And then the third theme I wanted to talk about is also psychology, but this again expands one step outward. And this is the question of the national psychology. And I'm going to tell this story very quickly, but starting decades ago, because when you're talking about the national psychology, you're on an entirely different frame. I've expressed my optimism about Washington, but is the country ready for the sort of shared sacrifices that are needed to get control of some of our problems? And the essential problem was illuminated to me several months ago when I was driving home listening to NPR on my NPR station in D.C. We've got a program every Sunday night which airs old radio broadcasts. And the particular Sunday night I was listening, they aired a show called Command Performance. Command Performance was a show that went out to the troops in World War II. And it was a variety show. And the particular episode they rebroadcast that night was the final episode. It was aired on VJ Day, the day World War II ended. In fact, it was broadcast live just hours after the Japanese announced their surrender. And it had all the stars on it, Bing Crosby, Bob Hope, Frank Sinatra, Marlene Dietrich. And Bing Crosby was the host, and he gets out there on stage, and he says, hours ago we learned we won World War II, but I guess we don't feel proud, we just feel humble. And this theme of humility was echoed throughout the whole program. And in the middle of the program, Burgess Meredith comes out and reads a passage from Ernie Pyle, the great war correspondent. And Pyle had written, and Burgess Meredith read, "We won this war because we have great allies. We won this war because we have brave soldiers. We won this war because we've been blessed by material abundance. We did not win this war because we are God's chosen people, or we're destined to rule the earth, or because we're better than anybody else. We're just glad we got through it. We should feel humble, not proud." And that was remarkable given the circumstances. Just hours after they've won the greatest victory in American history, this tone of humility. So then I drive home and I turn on the TV and there's a football game on and a quarterback throws a pass and somebody catches the pass and is tackled after a 2-yard gain, and the cornerback does what all professional athletes do after tackling this wide receiver. He does a victory dance celebrating his great achievement. And it occurred to me watching that I'd seen more self-puffing, self-celebration after a 2-yard gain than I'd seen after winning World War II. And this is a change in culture, a change in culture from a culture of self-effacement, I'm no better than anybody else, but nobody's better than me, to a culture of self-esteem. Look at me, look how good I am. And this is not only my nostalgia for an era in which I was not alive. There's actual some evidence to support this. And my favorite bit of polling evidence to illustrate this was done by the Gallup organization. They ask periodically high school kids, are you a very important person? And they asked this question in 1950, and in 1950, 12% of high school students said, I'm a very important person. They asked again in 2005, 82% said they were a very important person. And this is a change in how you see yourself. And this change, this rise in self-esteem, I think had a left-wing variant, maybe out here, especially in Marin County in the 70s, where we had an era of self-exploration and self-expression, produced magazines like The Self, what Christopher Lash called the culture of narcissism, Tom Wolfe called the me decade. I think there was a right-wing variant in the 1980s when self-promotion, self-branding, that the economics of self-promotion took the fore. And so our conceptions of ourselves changed. And this change, this expansion of self, had material effects. If you look at consumption in the 20th century, it floats along very solidly until about the 70s, and then it shoots up. So personal debt as a percentage of GDP was very stable for most of the 20th century at about 45% of GDP. And then starting in the 70s up until 2007, it shoots up to 143%. Total debt is stable at about 140%, including household debt and finance debt, and then it shoots up to 350%. This is a complete change in culture. Because if you see yourself as a very important person, you're going to want to outfit your life as befits your station. And you're going to want to prove to your neighbors and to your friends your station with your material belongings. And so that, I think, is one effect of the changes in our view of ourselves. The second is the public debt. Every generation has an incentive to spend on themselves and push the cost to future generations. No generation until our own has really done it in a massive scale. And I think that's in part because they saw themselves as part of a long historic flow from which they were no more important than anybody else. And I think that sense of the long historic flow, the debt owed to the past and owed to the future, has been lost. And as a result, we are running these phenomenal deficits with no end in sight. By 2019, interest payments on the debt alone will be about $900 billion, which is completely unaffordable. And then there's finally a deeper political shift. Previous generations thought of America as a republic and believed in republican virtue. And republican virtue was a distrust of self, that we all have a tendency in ourselves to favor ourselves, to be biased toward ourselves. And so republican virtue was the kind epitomized by George Washington, which was self-restraint. The democracy needed institutions to restrain the will of ourselves. That sense of republican virtue has been lost, and now we emphasize the democratic virtues. And the democratic virtues hold that what the people should want should be met by the government. The government should be responsive to people. It should be meeting the immediate demands of whatever the people want at that moment. This is a very different view of government, and I think it's led to the partisanship. Partisanship is a version of narcissism. It's a belief that your side has 100% of the truth. Rather than being a balancing of truth, it's a belief that your side has all the truth and the other side, and the country would be better off without the tension between your side and the other side, but simply if your side triumphed. And I think all these problems grew out of a different sense of self, a different sense of expanded self, a growth of self-esteem. And this is what helped contribute to the bubble, to the financial crisis, and to the great sense of political disillusion. More than all the causes, I think it's a deeper problem that we faced when we became a more proud of ourselves nation. And I would say, and this may be wishful thinking, that in the last few months, you've begun to see a change in that. You've begun to see a rise in the savings rate. You've begun to see changes in consumption patterns. You've begun to see a revulsion against some of the polarized rhetoric that marks the politics. And I do think there's been a bit of a psychological shift, a desire for maybe less self-puffery, maybe a sense of increased modesty. It is certainly true in the younger generation. If you want to feel good about the country, look at people under 30. They are a tremendously community oriented generation. A friend of mine who's president of George Washington University says of the community service that his students do, I don't know where these kids find lepers, but they find them and they read to them. And that is a sign that of a different mentality they have, that all the social indicators that went up in the wrong direction for decade after decade are now beginning to come down. Domestic violence is down, crime is down, abortion rates are down by a third, teenage pregnancy is down by a third. This is an incredibly wholesome and responsible generation. They're all going to have the biggest midlife crisis in human history in about 10 years. But up until that point, they're really repairing the society. And then finally, my sense that America is recovering from maybe an explosion of self-esteem comes, as all optimistic beliefs come, just by the act of walking around San Francisco, walking around Des Moines, walking around Albany. The act of observing American life is an incredibly still a heartening thing, because you come to the belief that the culture which defined us 200, 300 years ago is still alive. You see the culture of self-improvement. You see the culture of pragmatism and adjustment. You go to a suburban elementary school, you see the kids coming out of the elementary school. They've got these 80-pound backpacks on their back. If the wind blows them over, they're like beetles. They're sort of stuck there on the ground. You've got the moms driving up, or dads driving up to pick them up. In neighborhoods like this, they're driving Saabs, Audis, and Volvos, because in areas like San Francisco, it's socially acceptable to have a luxury car, so long as it comes from a country hostile to U.S. foreign policy. And because they're enlightened and progressive, they're going out and taking the kid out to Ben and Jerry's ice cream, the ice cream company with its own foreign policy. I wrote in one of my books that Ben and Jerry's should make a pacifist toothpaste. Doesn't kill germs, just ask them to leave. That would be a big seller. And then they're going out to the Whole Foods Market or the Trader Joe's, one of the socially enlightened grocery stores where all the cashiers look like they're on loan from Amnesty International. My favorite section of the Trader Joe's is the snack food section, because they couldn't have pretzels and potato chips. That would be vulgar. So they have these seaweed-based snacks. What we buy in my household, it's called veggie booty with kale. It's for kids who come home and say, Mom, Mom, I want a snack that'll help prevent colon rectal cancer. And so you begin to see the dynamism of America. And then I always say, if you really want to get a sense of the country, go to a Home Depot and watch an American man buy a barbecue grill, because that's when he's most emotionally exposed. And he's going into the grill and to the store, and he's doing the manly waddle men do in the presence of large amounts of lumber. And he's going up to the big grills, the Weber Genesis grill, because in America it makes sense to name a barbecue grill after a book in the Bible. And he chooses the 942-inch grill surface in case he gets the urge to roast a bison. He buys his grill, takes it out to his truck out in the big box mall, and he's in one of these parking lots with giant parking lots with a PetSmart over here and a Petco over there, sort of just across the parking lot, just over the curvature of the earth. You can see this gigantic Old Navy. And then maybe along the highway, there are all the suburban theme restaurants, which if they merge would be called Chili's, Olive Garden, Hard Rock, Outback Cantina. And then the Walmart over here, and then over here, my favorite, which is the Costco, which is like Walmart on acid. And it's over here. You can get your bags with 60 pounds of tater tots, your packages with maybe 120 pounds of detergents, or little packages with 6,000 Q-tips inside, which is 12,000 swabs, because there's one at either end. And I always go to these places thinking, you know, who comes here shopping for condoms? Because the quantities are so gigantic. And then you realize there are a lot of optimistic people in America. And finally, they're all having the same conversation, which is about how much money they're saving by buying in bulk. And so you think, you know, they're saying like, you know, we should get 10,000 popsicles because we were thinking of having kids anyway. And so then you realize that, you know, we go through these cycles, but psychology is very fluid. People change, people learn, people improve, people adjust, and a country that can invent veggie booty with kale will be fine in the long run. So thank you very much.
David, on behalf of the Commonwealth Club of San Francisco, let me thank you for a tremendous and thought-provoking talk tonight. I can tell you with some confidence that is the most applause that a Republican has received in the city of San Francisco since George Christopher, so that's been a number of years. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Dan Schnur, and I am a longtime supporter and participant in Commonwealth Club activities. Tonight, I'll be playing a role originated by Mark Shields. Actually, I've been asked to winnow through the questions that have been delivered to me here, and I will tell you that there are 250 people in the audience tonight. I have been given 750 questions. 675 of them, David, are about Sarah Palin, Christine O'Donnell, or Glenn Beck, so we'll get to those in just a minute. So given the 750 questions, I know technically we only have about 20 or 25 minutes left, but in order to get through the majority of our questions, I'd like everyone to get comfortable, because we're going to be here for a while. Before we go on to the questions, first of all of our thanks to the Toby Family Foundation for their sponsorship of tonight's program. Thank you, Tina, Frank, and your colleagues very, very much for helping us put this together. And for our radio and multimedia audience, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. Our guest today is New York Times columnist David Brooks, who is discussing politics and culture in the age of Obama. I will take prerogative before I get to the questions that have been left here. And in addition, David, along with the questions about Palin, Beck, and O'Donnell, there are questions which I will just run through quickly, which you can answer later at your leisure. Do you think Mark Shields talks too much? How lonely is it to be an old-fashioned Republican? And what is your favorite Bruce Springsteen album and why? But we'll come back to all three of those a little bit later. I'm going to take moderator's prerogative, and before I get to their questions, ask one of my own. I was struck by something that you said from people who we've talked to in Washington and in politics. So I will turn the question you ask them, and I'll turn it on you. What do you know now that you didn't know before?
I'm the one who asked that question. Let's see. I guess one of the things you learn is the incredible constraints people in government have on their actions and how they're slaves to circumstance. The first thing was, I've heard from many people is, you know, I thought if I was the head of an agency and I had ideas that I thought that agency should implement, I thought I would have some control over that and maybe would be able to implement some of those ideas. But people ahead of government agencies often have very little control over those agencies. And I guess that leads to a broader thing, which is that we are all players in a much larger game. And the power of individuals to enact change is actually reasonably, at least in the world of organizations, is reasonably constrained. And you really do rely on other people, and it's the ability to build relationships with other people. And I guess if I could put it that way, I really did come into this job and maybe into life with a pretty standard, middle-aged male view that what matters is individual decision making and what you decide to do with your life on any given day. But the more you get into it, the more you realize our individual decisions and minds and perspectives are shaped in deep and emotional ways by those around us. And what matters is not the decision that the individual makes, but the space between people and the nature of relationships between people. And that when you cover a White House, when you cover any organization, don't look at the individual, look at how they relate to one another. And that's probably generally true of things. So I try to analyze the nature of the relationships within a White House, within a Congress, within a political system, within a country.
Yeah, it's interesting that your answer comes back to a couple of things you talked about in your remarks tonight, in particular, ego and humility. Now, in his book, What It Takes, Lawrence Kramer talks about how a man, or not in 1988, but certainly today, a woman looks in the mirror and says, I am the most qualified person on the planet to be the leader of the free world. Now, that presumes, it seems to me, a much greater amount of ego than the power of the individual that you were just referring to. Right. Talk a little bit more, as you did earlier, about the dividing line between ego and confidence and hubris in our political leaders.
Well, I think you have to have a sense of hubris to run. Barack Obama, who is a man, as I say, I greatly admire, will say things in private and public which take your breath away. And the one that got out in the public was something he had said to one of his domestic advisors, and this was reported by Ryan Lizza in The New Yorker, and it was Obama talking to his aide, and he said, I want you to know I'm a better speechwriter than any of my speechwriters. I know more about policy in any particular policy area than my policy advisors, and I'm a better political analyst than my political director. And I would say if you can say that with a straight face, you have a high degree of self-confidence. And so, I don't think you run if you don't, and maybe you don't achieve greatness if you don't. But I would say the one thing he has also, and I think great leaders have, maybe more than him even, is a phrase which I think goes back, I don't know, maybe to David Hume, which is the phrase is epistemological modesty. It's the awareness, that the world is incredibly complicated and that we can never possibly really understand the world. And therefore you act while being aware of how flawed your understanding is. You don't design policies that are going to depend on you being a good knower of the world and a good designer of extremely complicated plans. And if you look at the wise leader, and one of the things we've learned is there's a difference between IQ, which maybe helps you a little, and mental character. It's the difference between processing speed and the ability to know your own mind, to know, to weigh your conclusions to the strength of the evidence, to doubt your own biases, to look at your own thought process honestly. These traits are completely unrelated to IQ. It's the ability, what they call metacognition, to think about your own thinking. And this is the real source of wisdom. And the people who have that have modesty. They know they're stupid. There are people like Warren Buffett who know they're stupid, know they don't understand, and therefore are always on guard about themselves. And I think politics is a harsh taskmaster. And if people don't come in with a sense of their own weakness, they're reminded of that because politics is so complicated, like any field of endeavor. Peter Drucker, by the way, once said, every time you make a decision, write down your reasoning for the decision, seal it in an envelope, and then open that envelope in 9 months. And you realize how wrong you were almost every time. And that's a good exercise. But I do think political leaders, and I think the president has adjusted and has become aware of how little he can possibly know and control.
David, you talked in your remarks semi-facetiously, I hope, that we are a country run by four-year-olds.
I was being generous.
You talked about mental character a moment ago. You talked about modesty. You talked about your admiration for President Obama. Who are the other six-year-olds in American politics? Who else do you admire on the current or recent political landscape? And tell us why.
Yeah. Well, first I would say, if I spend all this time around politicians, I would say if you go to lunch and dinner as I do with them, I often come away thinking impressive in private, reasonable in private. And that's only when I see them on C-SPAN where they're back to being their idiotic selves. And so I think most of the people in private know that their own position has some weaknesses, know the opposition's has some strengths. They're reasonably well-informed. But politics is a team game, and they have to hew to the party line when they're in public. And so I would say the people in government are generally in it for the right reasons. You know, the life just isn't that glamorous. You wouldn't do it unless you thought you were serving the country. Politics may seem, well, probably doesn't seem glamorous, but I used to think it was. But, you know, I was on a shuttle, this was to New York, on a Thursday night, and it was shuttle left at 10 p.m., but it was late, so we sat on the tarmac for 2 hours. We got in at like 1. There were about 9 members of the House delegation from New York, as well as Senator Chuck Schumer on that shuttle. They do that every week. The people who serve from out here, they fly back here every weekend. And they fundraise. Their lives are just miserable. They wouldn't do it unless they thought they were doing good. And so I think in general, they're worth more than the cynical way we treat them. I think the press is more cynical than the politicians, and I think the voters are more cynical than the press. And I think it's not quite fair. Among the people I admire, I keep a list of 5 or 10 people in Washington at any given moment I really admire. In case I'm feeling depressed, I can think of those people. And, you know, there are people like Tiger Woods, Elliot Spitzer, the situation. No, I'm just kidding. By the way, I have an all-time list. My all-time list includes people like San Francisco native George Shultz, who served the country, not himself, continually served the country in whatever role. Jim Lehrer's on the list, though don't tell him that. I'll deny it. Of the current, say, senators, I really admire Ron Wyden from up the coast here. Here's a senator with strong Democratic convictions, but is always willing to work with other people on the other line with very sophisticated policy ideas. I'm a big admirer of Lindsey Graham, the Republican senator from South Carolina. Again, somebody with strong conservative convictions, but willing to take risks, even at the danger to his own political danger. So I could go on, but there are many admirable people in politics. Individually, they're good. It's the system they're enmeshed in, which is problematic.
Well, you talk about the dichotomy between the public and the private politician. You allude to the pressures, as I understood it, from the news media and ultimately the public for that different type of role. So this gets to one of the terrific questions that we got from our audience here. And the question has to do with voter anger. We heard a lot in this last election about voter anger. And the question is, are voters angry, or are just the subset of angry voters the loudest?
No, voters are angry. that we've seen a series of institutional failures in government, in business, the church. I think there's the underlying theme of this last election is a fear of national decline. If you ask Americans, are America's best days behind it? 65% of Americans say yes. We've gone through periods of pessimism, but never as sustained a period as we're in now. People fear that not only have we lost something, but our institutions are fundamentally not up to the task. And that anger flows out of that. That disillusion flows out of that. I think Obama tapped into it. I think the Tea Party movement tapped into it in a different iteration. And by the way, I think we're not done with this. We are in a period of high social self-organization. We saw the Obama movement. We saw the Tea Party movement. I'm convinced that we're going to see a movement, or maybe it's already starting, a movement of people who fundamentally want to take care of the fiscal situation. You know, we are literally, there's no question about this, marching off a cliff fiscally. Countries fail because they lose wars or they get buried under their own debt. Serious nations don't walk off a cliff. And I think with the right leaders, with the right donors, there will be a mass movement in the next 5 years which will simply say, we're willing to take a sacrifice, if everybody's willing to take a sacrifice, to avoid a fiscal catastrophe. I go around Capitol Hill, I go to the White House, and I say, do you think there'll be a national bankruptcy? And I would say almost universally, people say yes. And I remember asking a White House economist, do you think we could take actions before we have a national bankruptcy? And he said, nah, I don't really see it. And I said, well, what kind of national bankruptcy will it be? Like, you know, the Argentina, Greece, decline and fall of the Roman Empire. It'll be pretty bad, maybe not as bad as the Roman Empire, but pretty bad. serious countries don't do that, don't walk into that. And so I think there's such a degree of anger, there will be a mass movement. A movement based on patriotism that says, at a time when soldiers and Marines are sacrificing their lives in Afghanistan, are you really not willing to sacrifice your cost of living adjustment? And I think that'll come.
One of the audience members asks a question which is particularly relevant here. It goes back to what you were talking about earlier in terms of the need for humility. And their question was, what will restore that humility? What I gather is, what will restore that humility is bankruptcy.
Well, that'll make us, there should be better ways. You know, I think there's a religious way. There was a book by a guy named Rick Warren down in Orange County who wrote a book called The Purpose-Driven Life, which sold like 25 million copies. And the first sentence of that book was, it's not about you. And that had great resonance. History reminds you it's not about you, it's about the long flow of generations. Parenthood reminds you of that. National service reminds you of that. Believe me, the soldiers, sailors, and Marines understand that it's not about you. They got no hair. There's nothing identifying them. It's not about them. I think a national service program, which we should have, would remind young people it's not about you. And so, I think there's a hunger for this, short of the true humility of a national decline and collapse. That also is humble-making, but not in a good way.
Well, you've written for many years about what you call a national greatness agenda, and there are those who refer to that. Patriotism is almost a secular religion. It sounds to me as if you use the two terms not quite, but almost interchangeably.
Yeah, well, patriotism is a faith. It's a belief in country, a belief in a relationship that exists before individual choice, something you're willing to devote your life to. And I think most politicians and most Americans have that in an incredible degree. Certainly servicemen and women have that. It's not a faith that squeezes out religious faith. The most religious people also tend to be the most patriotic because they're capable of this faith, of this enlarged vision. But I do think patriotism, I talked about this movement, I do think it will have to be a patriotic movement. Because if you're asking people to give up their home mortgage deduction, their cost of living allowance, some Medicare subsidies, why are you going to do that? You're only going to do it if you're going to do it for your country, and you're going to do it believing your institutions will impose sacrifice fairly. And so far, we haven't had that kind of movement, but I think the country is ripe for that. The National Greatness Movement I described really is, I described it earlier, this third tradition in American life, beginning with Hamilton, going to Lincoln. It is the great tradition that's sort of dying in American life, looking for a leader and to sort of balance out the liberal and conservative tradition we have. And, you know, I know for a fact, I know we met through John McCain years ago. I think he tried to embody that tradition. I think Obama, to some degree, would like to embody that tradition.
You wrote, and again, I quote an audience member, question related to your wonderful column from December, Ben Franklin's Nation. Talk, if you would, about the future of American exceptionalism and our place in the world order.
Well, you know, why are we exceptional? I do think we're exceptional because of our history. Settlers from Europe came here hundreds of years ago, and they saw forests stretching out, they didn't know it, but for 3,000 miles. They saw flocks of geese so big it took them 45 minutes to take off. They saw clams and oysters bigger than anything they'd ever seen. And they had two thoughts. One, that God's plan for humanity could be completed here. And two, that they could get really rich in the process. And so this has created a vulgar moral materialism, which has driven us. We work harder, we move more, we divorce more, we kill each other more. It's energy. And I think, you know, China's in, God knows, it's an energetic country. But that moral materialism, which, by the way, explains Whole Foods and Trader Joe's and Restoration Hardware and all the other companies up there in Marin County, that is still a propelling force. That we, you know, the phrases that run through American history, an American is a materialist or is a moralist working on matter. These still are true. Tocqueville came here in the 1830s, and many of us had no ancestors who were there then. And yet the America Tocqueville described in the 1830s is still basically America today. And so that pragmatic sense, which was part sort of spiritual, but part Benjamin Franklin pragmatism, doing what you need to do to rise and succeed, and sort of grubby materialism, those things are still around, and that's why culture changes extremely slowly, even despite what we might try to do to it.
You talk about the things that unify our country, both historically and culturally. We have several questions about one of the disunifying forces in America today, and that is the technological advances that have led to fragmentation of our news media. Your colleague, Nick Kristof, refers to this as the Me Network. I, in my speeches, talk about politics in an iPod nation. But in a world in which people choose between, often to mutual exclusion, between Huffington and Hannity and O'Reilly and Olbermann, how do you remind them of the unifying traits that you were just talking about?
Yeah, well, it's a problem. Though it's worth noticing, as Morris Fiorina is a political scientist at Stanford, he points out that more Americans own ferrets than watch Fox News. That's an unexpected but true statistic. And so there are some people who watch Fox, a lot fewer number who watch MSNBC. But most people are not in either category. And these are people who are, you know, what's been significant is the rise of independence. And these are people who don't feel represented sort of by either orthodoxy. And so there's that which has a fluid effect on our politics. But But the effect on technology is mixed. On the one hand, you do get this segmentation, and the best story that was told to me, this was also at Fox. Fox, like all the channels, has a little logo on the bottom of the screen. The problem is some people turn on the TV at 6 in the morning, and they keep it on Fox till midnight when they go to sleep, and the logo burns into their TV set. And so Fox had to move the logo around just to not ruin people's TV sets. So you do get some of that effect. But computers have had a surprising effect. You would think that websites would be even more segregated than the TV stations. In fact, according to a study I read at the University of Chicago, that it's so easy to click a mouse. People go from conservative sites to liberal sites and back again. So despite my expectations, the web is less ideologically segregated than TV. And so some of the technology may allow people to more easily sample people on the other side. The dangerous thing, though, by the way, is that geographic segmentation is increasing. So Republicans move into Republican areas, Democrats move into Democratic areas, and the number of counties in this country where one party or another has a landslide majority has doubled in a generation. And so that segmentation is real. Nonetheless, my belief is Washington and politics are more segregated and more polarized than the country is. This polarization we see is mostly a product of Washington and elites, not from the country as a whole.
We have several questions from audience members about the newly announced No Labels movement. Right. Given your last statement, then, is it reasonable to assume that the next Tea Party movement, the next MoveOn.org movement, will come from the political center?
Well, I think so. And, you know, I should say two things. One, I was the first speaker at the No Labels event. So I have some affiliation. I will shout. We're back. Okay. That said, I've never seen a movement thrive that started with the word no. And as much as I respect the movement and the ideas behind it, the need for discussion, you've got to stand for something and then hope people gather around it. And I think this concept of using government for limited but energetic means to enhance social mobility, getting early childhood education, getting human capital, training policies, education policies, industrial policies that will help middle-class people get jobs, a whole array of policies that is not big government, it's not small government, it's limited government but productive government. I think that's the agenda that you really have to drive through this, not simply saying we're against people. You got to be for something.
Our last question, which is, a recent reflection of a theme that you've been talking about both tonight and for some time, gets to the many questions we received from our audience members about the aftermath of the tragedy in Arizona this past weekend. Historically, presidents, leaders of both parties, whether it was the Oklahoma City bombing, the Challenger explosion, leaders have been able to rally the country and use tragedy as a means to move our society toward the kind of goals that you've been articulating, David. Does that type of opportunity exist in the aftermath of last weekend's events? And what would it take, not only for our political leaders, but for those who follow those leaders, to realize that?
Yeah, well, it has happened, but to me a speech, say Obama gave a speech saying, we need more civil discourse. Would saying you need more civil discourse actually produce more civil discourse? I'm going to botch this, but Edward Gibbon had a phrase in Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. Let me see if I can get this right. It was about business ethics. And he said, courses in business ethics will only have an effect on those whose happy natures make them unnecessary. Meaning, only people who are naturally honest will pay attention to business ethics. The people who cause the problems, the words won't matter. And so I guess what I would say is needed is not only a speech, but a a platform, which I tried to describe earlier, which would actually cut through the polarization, a series of actions which would actually involve working together. And that would be an agenda which would shake up the trench warfare. You know, we had trench warfare in World War I where nobody moved and people just died. And then somebody invented the tank. And the tank cut through the trenches. And so politically, we need a tank to cut through the trenches that have been existing. And so he'd have to create a move and a movement that would really break through our politics and reframe them and reorganize them in a different way. And then people would have to adjust to this new technology.
Well, please join me once again in thanking our guest, David Brooks, for an extraordinary presentation tonight.